sustainability leadership, which is an independent part of the University of Cambridge that works to support and enable leaders to tackle global challenges and to deliver a more sustainable economy. One of the things that we are most proud of is that we run a number of business leadership groups, including our corporate leaders groups in the UK and across Europe, and that we're able, through those groups, to connect with other like-minded business groups around the world. And so I'm really pleased that we are hosting today's conversation to talk about a very exciting development, a relaunch of our efforts to connect up those groups with international sister groups around the world, both the ones that already exist, but ones that we are able to help foster and bring into creation. We have this, you know, we are already connected to a number of sister groups, partly through our membership of the Women Business Coalition, which is a great international coalition that we are very pleased to be part of. But we're also very pleased that there are a number of groups that we've been connected to in the past and have indeed helped found and support and mentor over the years, and now have now in turn learned a lot from speaking to them. So it's this existence of coming together, leadership groups of business that are helping to drive the conversation in their own context, in their own country, that has been a really critical part of helping change the way that climate policy is being delivered in many, many countries around the world. We see it as a really important development, and we want to kind of try and develop that and build that to even greater levels of effectiveness in the countries where it exists and bring it to life in countries where it doesn't exist. So it's a very exciting conversation. Today we're going to have a brief discussion. We're going to hear from a range of speakers, including some of those other groups that I mentioned, some of the key businesses that we work with. But to set the scene, I'm very pleased that we have a keynote speaker who is a policymaker, former minister in the UK, but a leader of a review in the UK about how the UK can best deliver its climate target, its net zero target, and particularly bring in more business logic into that. So I'm very pleased to have Chris Skidmore, MP, to speak to us today. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this kind opportunity to address you today. I'm honoured to be here for the relaunch of the Climate Leaders Network, Corporate Leaders Network for Climate Action. I'm doubly honoured that you've chosen to listen to me today rather than go off and listen to President Biden. Deeply grateful. I hope you're able to catch a speech later. But I think this is a really important moment in terms of, as was stated, we've had a number of corporate leaders groups in the past that have highlighted the opportunity for collaboration, for shared best practice, for ensuring you have that opportunity to meet, to discuss ideas, to come together. And to be honest with you, that's one of the things that I think we need more of in the UK. It's one of the reasons why I've taken forward the Net Zero Review. Sorry, is this a bit sort of distracting? Can we? Otherwise, I'm happy to move to a mic if that sounds a bit better. So what I wanted to do today was to talk about the Net Zero Review that I'm the independent chair of, and why the UK is sort of taking this forward, and how this then relates into, I think, the work that the Corporate Leaders Network for Climate Action will be taking forward. 3 years ago, I was the minister responsible for signing Net Zero into law. And actually, it was an interesting sort of case study, I think, in seeing a country deciding to take decisive leadership on climate. The UK became the first G7 country to legislate for net zero. We'd already introduced the Climate Change Act back in 2008, and at that time we had an 80% emissions reduction on 1990 levels that was set into law. But what that meant was that for that 20%, many organisations and companies could claim, for whatever reason, that they should be considered in that 20%. And it became clear that not just to meet our emissions reductions in the climate budgets that were set out, if we were going to be serious on climate change, everyone needed to be responsible for taking action. So moving from 80% to 100% was a really key moment for UK businesses. What I didn't realise was how much of a key moment it would be for the rest of the world. And if you told me 3 and a half years on that I'd be here at COP27 with 90% of the world's GDP under some form of net zero target, I simply wouldn't have believed you. And why did net zero go viral is a good question. fascinated by what makes good policy. How do we deliver and implement effectively is a key question for policymakers. All too often in climate policy, and in particular energy policy, and in my own government, we've seen things go disastrously wrong. Schemes that have failed to take off, projects that have run out of money, projects that failed to incentivize supply chains. Now, why did those fail? Because I think they didn't listen to that interface and the voice of business that recognizes the demand on the ground and understands how to deliver. And it's that agency of delivery that I think is a common theme here at COP27. The Glasgow Climate Pact ended up settling the Paris rulebook. We now have those NDCs, most of them interfacing with the net zero commitments. But talk is cheap. We now have the strategies, but they are just paper strategies. We now need to implement and deliver and show in real time what change, not just for 2050, but for 2030, looks like. And that means countries coming together to work out what is best, not just for their national economies, but how they can share ideas and bring down the cost of renewable and clean technologies by working together on shared projects, sharing knowledge and information by which they can demonstrate what best practice looks like, but critically, making sure that best practice doesn't remain best practice. I see some fantastic examples of pilots and demonstrators and local communities coming together, but what do we need to do to unlock that to ensure that this becomes the new normal, that we can get rid of best practice by ensuring it's just enshrined across the board? So what we see in one country, we can emulate elsewhere. Understanding there may be differences in legislation and regulation, but where can we adopt, where possible, that best opportunity to change? So for the review I'm taking forwards, 3 years on, it's not so much about the targets. I'm not seeking to review the net zero target. I'm not seeking to reopen any of our frameworks. I'm not rowing back on our climate commitments, and I'd be the last person to do that. Rather, what I want to do is to say, these are the targets. As I said, talk is cheap, politicians are fond of it, but climate action requires action. So how do we deliver that action? By looking at those commitments and providing the guardrails, ensuring against the policies. To say, if we've got an EV target, if we've got a heat pump target, if we've got a decarbonising the power supply by 2035 target, how can we make sure we don't go off track? What do we need to do now to safeguard that target for the future? And how can we think about a systems-based approach that recognises we need to build up supply chains, build up capabilities, build up capacities in order to be able to demonstrate that we're actually going to reach the target? And also, how can we do this by taking the whole of society with us? I think businesses know better than government. As salespeople, you can't do anything unless people can see what you're doing is going to make a difference to their lives. Where is the utility of the product? And the product here in net zero is demonstrating that the energy transition isn't just about tackling climate change and the environment, incredibly important though that is. We're doing this because it's going to make people's lives better. And trying to communicate that to people, that it's going to make them warmer, richer, have improved home standards, improved health outcomes, improved communities, better public transport, all of these co-benefits, the business knows how to communicate effectively to its customers, is what I think governments need to learn from business. And so I've been going around the country in the UK, listening to every sort of devolved nation, every region, to find out, again, what's working well, what can we scale up. Also, I've been holding sort of round tables with every sector, every business group and organisation to ask them, what are the opportunities for the future that maybe we haven't encapsulated in our own net zero strategy, but where are those barriers for deployment? Where can we identify along a number of horizontal axes, the regulations, the legislation, the government procurement, government competitions, government investment, skills, where are those opportunities to say, this is blocking a pipeline of supply? How can we unblock it and make sure that we can deploy the supply of energy faster? But also, how can we ensure that companies can decarbonize in a way that is going not to affect their balance sheet? How can we make sure that decarbonization is going to be profitable and an investment? I think one of the mistakes we made actually adopting net zero in the UK is that we brought net zero forwards without really bottoming out a strategy of how we were going to deliver. And also, when we brought net zero forward in legislation, it was always the dynamic was always about the cost, so £2 trillion or 1% of GDP. And obviously, since then, the media has picked up on saying, "Oh, this is going to cost the taxpayer, 2% of GDP." It's not, because the cost is actually going to be borne by the private sector. You know this, but for yourselves, it's not a cost. It's a huge opportunity and investment to be able to look again at supply chains, to look again how you do things more productively and efficiently, and to be able to create new business models. Yes, we'll have that initial cost, but we'll return an investment in spades over time. So I think this opportunity, this relaunch of the Corporate Leaders Network for Climate Action is really exciting, because it's going to bring together constituent countries, not just from the West, not just from America, Europe, from the UK. I think the ambition here is to reach countries from Latin America, from Asia, from Africa, to highlight some of those voices that maybe haven't traditionally been heard, but deserve to demonstrate the action they're taking, and also that we can learn the lessons from them. And in the review I'm taking forwards, which I've got to do by the end of the year, I'll be looking to put together a range of policies along a number of pillars. So what I've tried to articulate is that we can deliver net zero better if we strengthen its foundations for the future. So that includes looking at securing net zero, identifying security of supply, how do we make sure the lights stay on, how do we onshore our capabilities as best possible on the energy transition, working internationally in collaboration so we don't duplicate our efforts. The real risk of energy sovereignty and energy nationalism is actually we close our doors to each other, when actually having the opportunity as companies to collaborate and work out where we can best place our efforts is really important for lowering the cost of the transition. Secondly, looking at net zero and the powering net zero, so each sector by sector, what can we go further faster, what are the barriers? Then net zero in the economy, listening to the voice of business, not just the multinational companies, but really importantly the SMEs, and understanding for those companies that want to decarbonize, want to go net zero, how can we build capability, capacity and knowledge in order to allow them to make their own net zero journey. Fourth pillar is then net zero in the community, because I passionately believe in the next stage of net zero is going to be local. You know, we're all here talking about what we're going to achieve as countries. It will be a regional approach in every country that delivers net zero further, faster. You all know in your respective nations which are the regions that have a different agricultural footprint, a different industrial footprint, you know, a different housing footprint. They'll all need to reach net zero in a different way. But actually, the commonality between our nations will be we're going to be able to work together on how to deliver energy efficiency measures in high-density housing. You know, there are cities that are comparable both in the UK to China to New Mexico, where we can work together on these shared problems. That's very much obviously what the Breakthrough project is about. Fifthly, I'm interested in looking at net zero in the individual and the household. So how can we, again, what's the retail offer? For people who've got a mortgage, they want to think about changing their car to an EV, they want to think about, you know, moving to a heat pump, they want to transition to net zero, but they're worried about the cost. And this is where the voice of business is going to be absolutely critical. Because I often think, you know, when it comes to a mobile phone, you know, the government didn't pay for my mobile phone. No one sort of said, right, you know, we need this upfront cost of capital to be able to deliver this. It happened because firstly, it was a utility that people wanted. The innovation was there to be able to deliver a cheaper product over time. And thirdly, we created the financial mechanisms by which to deliver a lower cost of capital through private financing and loan systems over time. And that was delivered by business, you know, for business, because you recognize that actually creating industries for utilities for people for the future, you know, needs to happen. We need to come together to achieve that. And we can't often wait for government to achieve it either. So I think if government had designed the mobile phones, they might have looked very different to what they look like now. I would like to think actually what would have happened. And then finally, thinking about pillar six, net zero in the future. What are the technologies that we've yet to develop? It might be direct air capture, new nuclear, it might be looking at hydrogen. How can we collaborate as nations? You know, again, recognizing our respective expertise is spread across the world. How can we share our knowledge? How can we, at the same time, recognize that one country may have competitive advantage, but there will be a learning opportunity for other countries to trade in not just the materials and create new international supply chains, but in people. And that's the other thing I think that's really interesting about having the corporate leaders network for climate action, is as people you will come together and share your own respective skill sets. And I'm very keen in the review also not just to focus on the UK. So if anyone wants to send me any international examples, what I'm keen to demonstrate is that we are now in a net zero race, not to compete with each other, you know, that's futile. The race is obviously a race against time on tackling our emissions, but at the same time, this international shared opportunity for us to look at other nations and say, this is what success looks like, this is what good looks like, this is what excellence looks like. Why aren't we doing what Germany are doing about energy efficiency? There are many things in the UK that I look at all the time and say, why can't we be like Norway? But I'm sure other countries turn to the UK and look at us and say, why can't we be like the UK? It's just an irony that every country always underplays its strengths and looks abroad to see what other countries are doing best. But I think having this shared network, you'll be able to understand where we all sit on that journey. And it is a separate journey. We're all going to get there at separate speeds. Some will go further, faster, some will slow down, and some will accelerate. But by working together, we have the opportunity to achieve the common destination at the same time. So I'm honoured to be able to be here for the relaunch. I wish you all the best. I know it's just the start of a journey, but I ensure that this journey will mean that we will achieve net zero further and faster. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris, for your kind words and the very thoughtful words. And I think we couldn't have asked for a better articulation of the value of business and government working in partnership, which I think is at the core of the corporate leaders groups wherever they exist. So I think that's really, really nicely put. So we've been talking about this relaunch, and also thank you and well done for Chris for not only competing with the President of the United States, but also with quite a lot of background noise. So well done on that front, and well done to the audience for bearing with this on this front as well. We've been talking about the relaunch of the Corporate Leaders Network. I'm sure you want to hear a little bit more about what it is and how we want to work. So I'm going to hand over to my colleague, Beverly Cornaby, who's going to take us through a bit of a presentation before bringing in some of the sister groups around the world who have talked about how they work. Bev.
Thank you very much, Elliot. So I'm just going to run through a few slides just to introduce the group, but also set the context for it as well, because it's just, I know most of you know us, but it's just to say about, you know, how did this come about and how does it operate as well? So most of you actually in here know us, but for those that don't, we're from the Cambridge Institute for Sustainability Leadership. We convene the UK and European Corporate Leaders Group, and that is one of the key things that we do is in terms of convening. We bring together business voice with government voice, also often the finance voice as well. We do other things. It includes education, it includes research, and we also have an accelerator and sustainability program. But really what this is about is how do we convene globally, not just within the areas that we are at the moment. So the corporate leaders groups themselves, we have the UK and European corporate leaders groups, and we've got some of our members here in the audience. And what do they do? Well, we're convening the business voice, and it's a cross-sector voice, taking it to government to really kind of show what business wants. We do this, and just to say, as well as the UK and European corporate leaders groups, we actually have other groups that we're going to hear from in a minute as well. Some of them set up in a very similar way to us. So both of the corporate leaders groups were set up 15 years ago. They've kind of evolved over time, but generally the premise of them has stayed the same in terms of actually taking that business voice to government. CLG Chile and the Japan Climate Leaders Partnership were set up in very similar ways to us and operate in similar but different ways to us. Other groups have emerged, some of which existed previously, some of which are newer. And one of those we also hear from is the Spanish Green Growth Group as well. But what I want to say is about actually how do we bring about that change? You know, how are we trying to operate and actually how are we trying to increase ambition? And one of the way that we do it is through what we call the ambition loop. And the ambition loop is about actually how do you show ambition by business that can increase ambition by government, and in turn that can actually increase ambition by business. And then you go around in this loop that means that actually eventually we will get well on the way to net zero and we will actually meet our ambitions. And there's many key things of that, and some of it is things like, you know, business asking for policy certainty, asking for certain types of policy, ensuring that leadership's there in terms of government, which in turn can lead to business leadership. Businesses also are able to be proactive and kind of lead the way, and therefore bring government with them in terms of actually what needs to happen. And it's those ambition loops that we really want to support through this network. We want to enable that national level advocacy by business to really support climate ambition and to increase it on a national level. And not just within the UK and the European Union where we operate, but within other countries as well. And this is where we're looking at both the existing groups, but also bringing together potentially new groups in different countries. So just to introduce the Corporate Leaders Network itself, originally it was set up around 10 or so years ago, and it was done at that time to kind of bring together the groups that existed at that time. For various reasons, it just didn't kind of continue over time, and what we're looking now to do is kind of really build on the momentum that was actually started by the UK being COP president and also the high-level champion, Nigel Topping, the creation of the Race to Zero, which the Race to Zero really led to. I mean, I can't even, you know, I don't even know the exact number now. It keeps going up in terms of actually how many businesses have made commitment through the Race to Zero. But certainly in the UK, we've seen something like a sevenfold increase in companies making commitments to the Science Based Target Initiative in just the last 2 years, which is quite significant. We've also got, I think, the highest number of SMEs that have made commitments as well through the SME Climate Hub. And therefore, we're looking at actually how do we kind of build on that global momentum of businesses coming forward, making those commitments, showing that greater ambition, and therefore supporting them and kind of creating this global network where that actually they can also work to support in terms of increased government ambition as well. So the objectives really of the group is to, and I mean, I think actually, Chris, you know, you touched on some of these points in terms of it's about, you know, the visibility of actually what is happening and what businesses are doing within their own countries. It's about coordination as well, and actually using moments such as the COP, you know, there's other moments as well, such as Davos, such as New York Climate Week, kind of key times when we can actually come together and collectively show what we're doing at a national level, but also then kind of promote that in terms of actually how we connect together and potentially forming collaborations that can lead to even greater impact. It's also about supporting the groups themselves with that national level advocacy. So looking at actually what is happening on a global stage, where is the progress, or where does progress need to happen, and actually how can we translate that into what businesses could be doing at a national level and support therefore the activities of the different groups. And part of it is also, as I've mentioned, about the sharing of practice between the different groups. We're all at different, you know, as Chris refers to, it's like every different country is at a different point in their journey. And there's some that are ahead in certain areas, some that are ahead in other areas. And actually, how do we come together to share what different countries are doing to support that raising of ambition globally? In terms of how it will operate, the CISL, so ourselves, will provide the secretariat for it. We're seeking to have it as a funded group so that therefore, you know, the members themselves don't need to pay into it. And in that way, we're aiming to kind of have regular meetings, to have collaborations, also supporting through academic knowledge and kind of drawing on the fact that we're based within a university. Some of our other, the other corporate leaders groups also have that kind of academic connections as well. So kind of trying to build on those and also build on some of the experts that we're linked into and be able to kind of use them to support the work of the groups and to be able to bring their knowledge to really kind of accelerate progress. We will be looking at the membership, so we do have a page that is has gone live on our website where we can have groups that can apply to it. What we're looking though in terms of members is groups such as ourselves, such as CLG Chile, such as J-CLP, who have similar ambitions and are seeking to operate in a similar way, and therefore that we can come together in kind of a level way in terms of actually the kind of raising of that ambition. We will obviously be, you know, open to applications, so we're hoping that there's some groups come forward that we're actually not aware of or that we kind of haven't got strong links to, that we can create stronger links to. And as I mentioned, actually, one of the things that we're also doing is looking at what are the opportunities to potentially create equivalents at corporate leaders groups in countries that may not have that business collaboration at the moment that is looking to do policy advocacy, and what are the opportunities there. So at the moment, we're actually already scoping one potential group in South Africa, seeing whether that is feasible, and we'll be looking to scope further groups as well if that, you know, once we've kind of learned from that process to see where there is other opportunities to bring business together to be able to operate in a similar way and do that national level advocacy. I'm going to now invite our colleagues from CLG Chile, J-CLP, and also the Spanish Green Growth Group, so Cajori, Teresa, and Gonzalo to join me now, and I'm going to be in conversation with them to explore actually some of the activities they're doing and actually how they're operating as different groups. Thank you for joining me up here. So the first thing I'm going to do is ask you each to introduce yourself and just say a bit about your group and about who your members are in terms of actually how you operate. So Cajori, I will come to you first.
Thank you very much. It's a great honor for me to be here. I am a co-chair of JCLP, Japan Climate Leaders Partnership. We were established in 2009, which was quite a long time ago, but the membership grew potentially in the past, in the recent, like this 5 years probably, and because up until 5 years ago, we only had probably 20 companies, 20 members in the group, but now today we have 225 businesses, companies in the group. And the total sales is approximately 130 trillion Japanese yen, which is about 900 billion US dollars. And I always use this number. The next one is 65 terawatt hour of electricity use in total with all these companies. And I like to use this number because it shows, because one of the biggest message that we are always wanting is that we want more renewable electricity. And this shows how much demand we have in Japan. And all these utility companies come back and say, well, nobody wants renewable energy, so that's why it's expensive and we have, you know, we don't make it that much. But no, you're wrong. We have 65 terawatt hour of companies who are willing to buy. So that's a very strong message that it's one of the key message that we had for this past couple of years. And so I'll just leave it there. It's a quick introduction. Thank you.
Thank you, Teresa.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for the invite. I think it's a pleasure and an honor to be here and to share a bit the experience from Chile. We are CLG Chile. We were founded in the year 2009, so very similar that in Japan. However, we are only 24, so we are lying a bit behind. But I think it's great. We have 24 firms, and I would like to say a bit about the composition of those firms, because we have about 8 firms which are mining or cement companies. We have 5 electricity companies. We have 3 banks. We have 1 technology, 1 retailer, and other sectors. But we haven't covered all the sectors. So that's one of the challenges that we want, okay? Because obviously we are a mining sector, and that's important for us. We produce a lot of renewable energy. You know, we are into green hydrogen now as well. But we would like, I mean, in order to make it, you know, net zero, we need everybody on board, and therefore we need to expand towards other economic sectors, as well as the supply chain. So, yes, we are very happy. We have 2 firms that are here with us, Banco Estado and Soquimich from Chile. So it's a pleasure to share with you, and we would like not only to share the successes, but also not call it the failures, but the processes, perhaps. I think that's very important, and we really appreciate this opportunity to do that. So thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you. And Gonzalo.
Thank you. Good afternoon to everyone. I'm Gonzalo Sainz de Viera. I'm the chairman of the Spanish Green Growth Group. So we are in between two groups, because we are 60 members. We represent 60% of the Spanish stock market. That is a lot. So we have financial firms, like the biggest banks, you know, the biggest utilities, you know, the biggest consumers. So I think, I haven't done this number, but I think we will represent something like 40% of the energy consumption in in Spain. And so we were created only 10 years ago. And we are very active in Spain, you know, having conversations with political parties, with environmental NGOs. And the first thing I want to share is that last year we review our bylaws, our mission and our vision, because I think it's very healthy because things are moving very rapidly. So we decided to review our bylaws to be much more ambitious and to adapt our objectives, our vision and our mission to this very changing environment. So thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you, Gonzalo. So what I want to explore with you is some of the kind of the challenges, the opportunities, kind of what the groups do, and also some things about your members as well in terms of what they're doing. And so the first question I want to ask you is about actually, you know, what are some of the policy challenges you're facing and actually that you're trying to address within your own country, that you're taking the business voice to, that you see as critical for them to be able to have influence and, you know, and that supports them in their own activities? Don't know, Teresa, if you want to go first.
Yes. Well, I think that's our one of the things that we are more proud of. I mean, if the government wants to have a benchmark from the private sector in Chile, they will come to us, okay, in terms of climate change. And that's very important because that means that we can talk, we can have our voice, we can discuss things related with regulation, which are very important for the private sector, because in the end, we want regulation, we want certainty. That's the way that we need, you know, in order to do good businesses. And we've been, you know, talking and participating in the process. We just got the law, the climate change law in Chile. And we have a lot of talking, you know, and participating at the different stages of the development of the law. And so we are very proud of that connection. And not only with that, but also with the Ministry of Energy, obviously with the Ministry of the Environment as well, with the Ministry of Economy, the Ministry of Finance. So we have a very easy way of communication, which is extremely good. Yeah?
Brilliant. And you've actually reminded me that probably one thing I should have said is that actually the origin of actually our UK and European corporate leaders groups was when the UK was bringing its climate change, you know, was considering climate change and whether it should take any action. The then Prime Minister, which was Tony Blair, actually stood up and said, well, I want to hear from the voice of business. And that was actually what led to our, you know, the creation of the corporate leaders groups. And as a result of that, actually, those first businesses that stood up, you know, they helped influence and actually get the UK, you know, the UK Climate Change Act. And actually then a couple of years ago, we then convened, you know, we produced a letter and actually put pressure on the government from business to say, actually, we need a higher target. And that was when the net zero by 2050 target came in, and it was seen we've got a direct correlation between that letter going in and the business pressure, and then Prime Minister Theresa May actually putting it into law, and it shows the influence actually the groups can have in the formation of those policies. Gauri, I'm going to come to you. I mean, you talked about renewable energy. I was wondering whether you've had, you know, any successes or still challenges actually in that area.
Thank you. About the success, first of all. Yes, I did talk about renewable energy, but before that, we were hoping the government to come up with a target, because we need targets in order to any policy or whatever to come forward. So our mission back in 5 years ago, it was for the government to come up with a decent reduction target, which is 50%, of course. And actually, Japan did come up with net zero target and 46%, but it was close enough. And of course, it was probably because UK did the net zero and Japan was influenced by that. But I would like to take some credit that our group had in influencing the government to bring up the NDC. NDC. So So we take it as our success, because we were really happy that the government did bring up to that point. And now the challenge is we have to implement a lot of different things. I think the biggest challenge that we have right now is we want the carbon pricing implemented. So that would make a lot of businesses, it will change the way we do business, and it will sort of force business to change, and innovate in an innovative way. So that's a challenge right now. We don't know when, but we're trying. We will hopefully soon. That's where we are.
Brilliant. And it's probably worth mentioning that actually some of these things do take time, that, you know, there is that kind of constant pressure and constantly asking and actually kind of going with the right evidence, going with the right information. And I think that's an important part. And sorry, just to say, if anyone's watching and seeing us swat away, there's flies coming up around us, which isn't the most pleasant. They go for our faces. Gonzalo, would you like to come in terms of?
Yes, I agree with what you say, for instance, on carbon pricing. And it's important to wait for the right timing. For instance, now with the very high energy prices, maybe it's not the time, you know? But I want to comment something, Maria Teresa said that you are very flexible or very quick in the answer. We are very quick as we're in the answer compared with, it comes with a person with the microphone to the speaker. One of our elements is that we don't go into the detailed regulation. This is impossible, because it will be impossible. I mean, we have firms from different sectors. We just go to the objectives, positive messages, and, you know, great policies. And in that, because we all agree on these policies, we have to put a price on carbon. But we don't go, we need to put a price of carbon of 65 euros or 6 per ton. No, because this will start a debate. So we are very rapid in the I'm very flexible in the answers from the government. For us, the main challenge now is implementation and the view of more conservative political parties. So we are doing a great effort in Spain with the more conservative parties, linking the climate crisis with the energy crisis. I think this is a very important driver, because the origin of the crisis is the same, energy model based on fossil fuels, and the solutions are the same. So there is a part of the society, you know, that will support that for the energy crisis, that are not so convinced about climate crisis. So I think it's an important driver, and things are moving forward very fast, and hurry maybe so in insulation and things like that, and because of the energy prices. So the decarbonization is going fast, not just for energy crisis, to link, you know, our objective to the changing objectives of society, I think is very important, to be flexible. Thank you.
Brilliant, thank you. And actually, you brought up a good point there around the fact that actually, you know, what we're looking at is these being leadership groups. And so actually, you know, they're not, I mean, we certainly, I mean, it may be different for J-CLP or CLG Chile on some areas, but certainly our own leadership groups, that's what we're trying to do, is we're trying to look at actually what is the gap in leadership at a government level, and actually what is the direction of travel. And, you know, as long as we can see that direction of travel, then we will look at, okay, where are the other gaps? Where do we need to push? So therefore, having an overall target is one of the first things, but then actually what the kind of the next level in terms of the leadership that is needed. And certainly, yeah, I mean, this is, you know, being talked about as an implementation COP, the next one will be even more so. And I think that's where it's important as well for, you know, corporate leaders groups to actually show that leadership, which kind of comes on to my next question, which is around the members themselves. So we talk about these being corporate leaders group. Ourselves, we have membership criteria that means that we require all of our members to actually have really strong commitments, you know, now be part of the race to zero, and ideally going beyond that as well. But we also ask them to have really strong sustainability strategies to kind of not be coming out. They can't be coming out with any conflicting messages. So there's a strong due diligence process that we go through, and the other members have to accept them as well. And so therefore our members are undertaking, you know, what we consider leadership actions. And I was wondering whether you can talk about your own members in terms of the leadership actions that they're taking, that you're seeing, and actually how they're operating in terms of what they're delivering. So Kahoria, do you want to come to you first?
Thank you. Yes, it is. I agree that you have to have a strong commitment, but I said 225 companies, but we do have a separate tier sort of within the group, and not every single 225 company can come up with the highest stringent commitment, but we do want them in, utility companies, you know, big companies, we want them in, we don't want to lose them. So we have about, I think, 30 companies, is it? It could be 40, 30 plus companies that are in the first tier. They are the leaders of the whole industry, wherever they are in. They're really committed to net zero, much faster than the 2030. Well, they're committed net zero in 2050, but some are 2040, 2035, or so on. So, and we expect, one of the things that we expect from our members in that first tier is for them to announce that, to publicly announce that they are going beyond whatever the nation is. And that gives the whole other industry, other companies, and the government a stronger message that, well, some companies can or are willing to do that more than the average or whatever. So that's one thing that we ask our leader companies to do.
Brilliant, thank you. I'm going to come to you next, Gonzalo, because obviously you're within a company at the same time, and so therefore you're running, you know, the Spanish Green Growth, you're president of it, but at the same time you're also a member of the European and UK corporate leaders groups through Iberdrola and Scottish Power. So I mean, you know, obviously you can talk about your own leadership, but obviously how do you work with then the other members of your group in terms of, you know, the leadership they're undertaking, or kind of what you're seeing, or the membership, you know, how they are members of the group?
How they are members of, I think it was very important this revision of the bylaws. And when we reviewed the bylaws, we state that our objective was to move from a fossil economy to a renewable economy. And this was very clear state. So as a result, some companies left the group. Yeah, because we have very clear positions. And we didn't like it at the beginning, as you say, because but I think it was a good decision for them and for us, because we have a more clear views. So maybe in your position, you cannot be so clear, but we can be extremely clear. We don't want fossil fuels, we don't want subsidies for fossil fuels, we have to move for renewables, renewables are more competitive. So we have very strong messages. So this revision of the bylaws was very important. And now we are facing a situation where a lot of companies want to join the group. The fees are really low, but we are in a process of reviewing which are the best ones, but at the same time we are looking for firms in sectors that are not represented. For instance, food, agriculture, business that are more close to society. So now, for instance, in our board we have winery, a wine company. Everyone knows this wine company. So it's good, because it's not like a utility or whatever. It's something very... So we're in this process of, on the one hand, selecting the most appropriate, and on the other hand, looking for firms that we think are good for our group.
Brilliant. Thank you, Gonzalo. And Teresa, I'm going to put the question to you slightly differently. In terms of your membership, I mean, you know, obviously you've got two of your businesses here, and you know, it's really great that, you know, having them involved in the conversations at COP, and I know they've been involved in other conversations that we've had. I mean, what do they also see as the value of being part of, you know, your CLG, but also being able to connect to other CLGs as well?
Yeah, I will answer your question, but let me say something regarding the previous one. Because the story in Chile is quite different from Japan and Spain. I mean, we are a developing country still. I mean, it's an OECD country, but we are a bit behind. So, for instance, just to give you some numbers, only 60% of our firms are raised to zero. And for us, for Chilean, race to resilience is something super important that we haven't talked here. And none of the firms have signed for race to resilience yet. Okay, so we have a lot of targets, goals. You see the fly comes with the speaker. And that's very important. So for that, and now I will link it to the following question, we need to work together. Okay, we cannot work in isolated terms. So it's not compulsory to be raised to zero to join, because we understand that it's very difficult. Another detail that I want to say is, like, only 60% of our firms are Chilean, okay, not multinationals. Okay, because for a multinational, I don't want to say that it is easier, but they may be, I mean, in advance, you know, compared to the Chileans. So, and then many of the Chileans have also, in fact, I have two Chilean companies here which are raised to zero. So that's outstanding, okay? So having said that, now I go to you just to have a bit more context. What is the value to belong at CLG Chile is to work together, okay? We cannot work in isolation, yeah? We need to work together, and that's why I've said that we need to involve other industrial sectors. But also we need to involve the supply chain. We need to green our supply chain, yeah? And that's the only way that it's going to happen. But I don't know if it's a difference or not compared to you, but we have the climate change law. So that helps us a lot. I mean, no firm has left CLG because we comply with the law, you know? So, I mean, it's like you cannot run away. There is a law, yeah? And there is a commitment, so everybody has to comply, yeah? Obviously, if you are under the race to zero, you have to be, based on science-based target, and you have shorter and medium-term commitments, which makes it better and, you know, more robust. But in the end, it's by law, you know? I mean, we are committed not only to the Paris Agreement, but to the net zero by 2050 by law, and that helps us a lot, yeah? But again, to come back to the point, why to be part? Because we need to work together. We need to interact with the government as a group. That's very important. We need to work in each of the industries, downstream and upstream, yeah? And getting to learn from others' experience, getting to be able to share with others, that helps us a lot, okay? So we have a stronger voice, but there is a lot to do, yeah, still to do. Yeah, to be done.
Thank you. And it's, and I have to say, I didn't mention race to resilience actually, because it's very, we find it very, you know, our businesses aren't necessarily also signed up to it because there's not an easy route in. And I think that's something we're looking at, is actually how do you bring resilience together with net zero to make sure businesses are actually tackling both. And I suppose my final question to you all, because we are coming to the end of the time for this panel, is, you know, what do you see as the value of being part of a global network and therefore being part of a kind of relaunch CLN? Gonzalo, maybe I'll go to you first.
Sorry, can you say it again?
I thought she was
going to be the first.
Sorry, I didn't give you a thinking time. What do you see as part of the value of being a global...
Part of the value?
Yeah, global network.
Yesterday, we had a very good conversation with the Japanese group. And I think just sharing these experiences among us is so valuable. Definitely, yesterday, we were talking of having more... conversations, periodical conversations on facing. For instance, the last thing I want to say is that we are launching a lot of alliances in implementation. So we are working a lot with environmental working groups, NGOs, and with local communities, because we are seeing a growing social opposition to the development of green solutions, you know, in a big scale. When you come to, you know, some renewables, everything is okay. But when you go to big installations and so on. And so, for instance, I would like, yesterday we were talking about that, big alliances with other people. And I would like to know of experiences of with alliances. So I think it would be extremely valuable. So I think from this conversation, I'm sure we need to go further and to spend time, you know, having these conversations, maybe in person, you know, it's so important. Maybe visiting Chile or Japan. We can go to Japan next time, but extremely valuable for us.
Brilliant. Kahori, I'm going to come to you next.
Okay.
I totally agree with what Gonzalo said, just said. But if I can add just one thing, if it's, of course, we get ideas, share ideas, collaboration, yeah, yes. But more than anything, from this COP this week, we, the Japanese team that we have about like 20 delegates. And the biggest thing that we earned was the moral support. Because if you, it being activists in in Japan, it gets very depressing from time to time because it seems like it's going to go nowhere. But coming here and talking to you and everybody, I can go back home thinking, knowing that, okay, this is the right way to go. So that's what I get.
Brilliant. Thank you, Teresa.
I think alliances are the key solution. I mean, there is no way we will be able to do it alone. And not only among the private sector, but the private sector with the different, you know, the public sector, the ONG, the NGO, sorry, the communities, local communities, etc., and the territory. I mean, in the end, our firms are located in a territory. And again, coming back to the situation of Chile, Chile is a country that is extremely vulnerable to climate change. So for us, adaptation is super important. That's why race to resilience is a big issue for us. And therefore, alliances, I mean, try to understand our territory where we are located, trying to work together. We are all part of the solution. I mean, we are part of the problem, but we are part of the solution too. So we need to work together, yeah?
And I think really that's the kind of key takeaway from me as well, because I feel like there hasn't been enough opportunities actually happen so quickly. And as I think, you know, Jessica, we'll hear from, said it's crazy, you know, it's like, but actually making sure we use this as opportunities to come together and to collaborate. And hopefully we'll be doing a lot more of that as the CLN now, in terms of actually kind of looking at conversations and the convening that we do. I'm going to hand back to Elliot now. So thank you very much to the panelists. And I think we're now going to hear from another panel.
Indeed. Thank you. Thank you, Bev, and thank you to that panel. I hope you all found that as insightful and useful as I did. Really good exploration of the kind of groups that we want to work with and the way that they've operated and the value live on stage of being able to compare and contrast experiences. So I think that's really good. Now, next up. So we've run a panel of business groups, and now we want to run a panel of businesses. So if I can invite up Harry Vahar, Julie Murad, and Jessica Lopez from Banco Estado to come and join me on stage, and we can start to have a conversation about what it's like. I mean, we already started it in the previous conversation, but what it's like to be a business in one of these groups, what the role of business is, and how business can be a kind of key contributor in this journey towards a net zero, climate neutral, sustainable future. I've already briefly introduced you, but maybe if I could just start by going down the panel, getting you to say a few words about yourself and sort of some of the ways that you've been involved in this agenda, and then we can start the conversation from there.
Okay, thanks, Elliot. Thanks all of you for being here. So I'm Harry Vahar with Signify, so this is the new name since 4 years, so not that new, of Philips Lighting, because we went through an IPO, but we are the world leader in lighting. And actually, I started our climate program at the end of 2003. So when I came back from Latin America, having worked there with a lot of pleasure. But then I also felt it's really clear that there's no win-lose on climate. There's no win-lose. If somebody thinks they can win, another can lose, in the end, we all lose. We're all in the same boat. So my view is really, you have to lead the future. You have to lead the creation of the future that we really need together. And that is what we try to do as a company. We still try to do that. Heck, there's a lot more is needed. Mostly on energy efficiency, but also by working with others together. Because we know that we need to double the pace of action in every domain. Efficiency, renewables, electrification, and so forth. So, really, also as was mentioned in the previous panel, I believe really in stronger together. So you have a stronger voice. The logic fits in a nutshell. And that's why it's great to work together with all of you.
Hi there, my name is Julie Morad and I'm with Salesforce. I'm part of our Nature and International team. For those of you who might not know Salesforce, it's a software company. We work with thousands of companies around the world to connect them with their customers, whether they are nonprofits, private companies, public sector, you name it. And for Salesforce, we're really committed to this vision of a net zero, nature positive future for people, with people being at the crux of that and supporting livelihoods. And that's why we're part of groups like J-CLP and CLG Europe and UK, which I'm a part of and represent Salesforce on. So really excited to have this conversation here with you all today.
Gracias. My name is Jessica Lopez. I'm president, chairwoman, se dice ahora, of Banco Estado. Banco Estado is a state-owned bank in Chile. It's a commercial bank. It's the biggest bank in Chile. And I'm a little bit confused because 1 week in the COP can make you crazy. I'm not a person from this ambience, but so I'm learning a lot, and I'm going back home tomorrow very confused in some things but very clear in others, but I have to say that I'm convinced that this is a thing that we all have to work and walk together, no way of any individual thing.
Teresa, Jessica, when we heard from Teresa how net zero is part of the legal landscape in Chile, what are some of the ways that Banco Estado is kind of trying to deliver on that agenda?
Well, formally we have to prepare a plan and to reduce emissions and all that stuff, but I think that because of our condition of state bank, we have a bigger responsibility because we are the biggest bank. We are the bank of the people. I mean, 16 million people of 19 million inhabitants are our customers. So I think that we not only have a responsibility, but a big opportunity. And we're working in very different, not different, but different paths. One has to do with our own emissions. The other, that's more than 90% of the problem, has to do with the financed emissions. That means the emissions of the companies that we lend money, or the papers, the investments that we buy in our portfolio, that we have in our portfolio. So I think that we have a lot of opportunities to move the thing in Chile, because we want, because it's important, and I think we have some power to push that.
Thank you. And Julie, you talked about Salesforce's commitment and its mission in this agenda. Could you make that concrete to us? Could you talk about some of the specific actions that you take as a company?
Absolutely. So this has been a very exciting year for Salesforce. We've been on our sustainability journey for more than a decade now. But this year, we added sustainability as a value to the company. So we have a set of core values: trust, customer success, innovation, quality. Those have been our values for quite some time, and the company is very rooted in them. But this year, we added sustainability as a value, which was huge for our team and is really comes after many years of working on sustainability. And when we add sustainability as a value, that means the entire company operationalizes it, which is super important, especially as we think about climate change and all the whole suite of actions that we need to take to make a difference. And so at Salesforce, we're committed to this net zero nature positive vision, but what does that actually mean? It means focusing on three key priorities: net zero, nature positive, and energizing the ecopreneur revolution. So as it relates to net zero, we are a net zero residual emissions company today. We are actively reducing our own emissions as fast as possible, have a climate action plan that details how we're doing that. We are offsetting any remaining emissions that we cannot abate now with high quality carbon credits. A lot of those focused on nature-based solutions, so touching on the potential to impact or influence a nature-positive future. And we're thinking about how can we do what we do best as Salesforce, right? Every company thinks about that. And our superpower is transformational technology. We have thousands of customers in every industry, as I said, and we've created a product for them, Net Zero Cloud, to help them manage and measure their footprint and make actionable decisions to help them get to net zero faster. So that's one of the things we're doing. We're doing a lot in the nature space around, we've been a founding member of 1T.org with the World Economic Forum and set our own target around 100 million trees, which we are actively making progress on. And I think the reason behind the nature focus is nature and climate are inextricably linked. And in order to achieve net zero, we have to focus on nature, we have to. And that's been a gap in a lot of corporate programs to date. It's been a gap in a lot of the climate conversations, and it's been really exciting this week to see nature brought up more and more at COP27. And we're excited to continue that conversation into COP15. And lastly, ecopreneurs, there's a lot of incredible solutions out there. This goes back to livelihoods. There's a lot of incredible folks that have great ideas, and we're working with Uplink as a founding sponsor of that with the World Economic Forum as well, to help accelerate those 50,000 ecopreneurs on the platform to create the solutions for climate change.
Brilliant, thank you. And maybe the same question for you, Harry. So if you can talk about some of the practical actions.
Yes, so let's say that most of what we try to do is then, let's say for the whole agenda on climate change, to advance that. So we're not so much in the business of advertising what we do, but we do find it really important to walk the talk. So something just before, actually in March 2007, the European 2020 program came out to save 20% on emissions, 20% renewables by 2020. We also felt at the end of 2006 that we needed to put a stake in the ground in the lighting sector. So we then called for the global phase out of incandescent light bulbs. Well, today that's sheer logic, but at the time that was 2/3 of our sales volume and also more or less 2/3 in pieces of the global lighting business. And we were getting the lighting sector along, so GE, Osram, and all the others, but they were not yet that convinced as we were. So when we made this call for action, first they grumbled a little bit, but then we got them along. But what was important is this really solidified the direction of the lighting sector. Essentially, stating at that time, all of the existing business can go, because we need to move to efficient, and eventually what is happening today to LED solutions. I think that was a really important moment. Because from that day on till last year, also the electricity consumption by lighting reduced from 19%, so almost 1/5 of global electricity consumption was lighting, 19% to 13% last year, and it will be 8% in 2030. So, and we do that, not let's say to get a pat on the back or to be in the news, but because it's very much needed. And the second thing that we did was also in 2015, when the Paris COP took place, nobody knew that the Paris Agreement would come out, so we were all very happy. But then before that COP, we also felt, we need to make a statement. So then we launched a commitment to become carbon neutral in 5 years' time by 2020. And we did that on the middle Friday, also on purpose on that day, because we knew in the weekend the government delegations will come in. And then on that Friday, so when we issued the press release, I was there with the CEO, he presented this. But then I sent it to Cristiano Figueres, I sent it to the World Bank, I sent it to the UN, to Achim Steiner, well, to all those people, to the IEA. And afterwards I heard from Cristiano that said, this really helped. Had to get the last few countries across the bridge, because she could show, there are companies that are doing this, and they can do it actually rather quickly. And we did it. So end of 2020, we were carbon neutral. And not, let's say, and actually also by reducing our emissions by 70% and moving to PPAs globally, actually also as a detail, and that's relevant in Europe, 25% of our footprint is in Poland. And in Poland, we are completely powered by wind energy. So also in Poland, we show this to the government. And so I think these are really things that you need to do together. So what can you do leading your sector? to lead the way, because the whole sector needs to transition, so you compete for the same future. And then also work together in the bigger community with renewables and all the others. But then also, as I mentioned, we believe in actions. Also now, with the European Green Deal, with the what came to be the Infrastructure Act, the Chinese 14 five-year plan, we launched a program called Green Switch, and we're rolling this out globally. So that also there, we work with companies, we work with cities, because that's where carbon neutrality happens. It doesn't happen in the ministry. It actually the cities and companies that have those buildings, that have those street lighting assets in our case. And so that's also yeah, to turn us into action, to turn us into real results. And also there, we know this is a triple win for the quality of living environment, let's say for the economy. And that means it's not only the national economy, or the household economy, or the city's economy, but also our economy. I think in that sense, as companies, I think also the tide is a bit changing. This is also, yeah, a legislator wants to make successful regulation. We want to do successful business, but all for the same goal. So for mitigation, let's say for creating, yeah, an ambient environment that is still livable, yeah, now and in the coming decades.
So Julie and then Jessica, I want to pick out a couple of threads in what Harry said and also in the previous panel and ask you about them. So one of the stories I heard from Harry there was firstly about leadership within business. So, you know, you explicitly talked about being sort of differentiated within your sector, but also how business can work to try and prompt change. And is that a story that, and I think that was also captured in the last panel, we talked about like the membership criteria in the corporate leaders groups. We talked about how working together is about, it's about more than changing the businesses, but it's about changing the wider context. Is that a story that you recognize, Julie? And how do you feel Salesforce takes part in that journey?
Some fun music around us. Yeah, exactly. I totally think that that story resonates. It's absolutely true. We need the enabling environment around companies, around business to enable, you know, it was mentioned before, that certainty within policy. Companies need that to make decisions. And we have some really ambitious and progressive companies out there right now that can take more forward-looking action, and that just kind of creates this great virtuous cycle that is really important. But collaboration is absolutely critical. So I think one of the great benefits we've seen in being in the group is just that exposure to other sectors, to our many of whom who are customers as well. It's really interesting, and there's a lot to learn from one another, so that it isn't just tech companies fighting for this one thing, right? We're all, I think, really well aligned. You know, I'm a member of CLG Europe, CLG UK. That's the group that I'm most present in, and I feel like we are really aligned in that vision. And it's not a static vision. I think the end goal remains the same, but we've been having some great conversations recently about how do we progress the future of this group so that it does remain ambitious, so that it does continue to meet the demands of today with the energy crisis in the EU as well. So it's been a real pleasure to be part of that group. And I think for us, what's been helpful is we've published our policy priorities, which have really helped to kind of centralize our own internal view as Salesforce around what are we trying to advocate for, so a bit more specific, and that complement of what we as a software company would like to see for the future, as well as how that meshes with the higher ambition of these groups, is really powerful, and has been really instrumental in terms of us engaging in policy in the regions where we operate.
Brilliant, thank you. And maybe if I can move down to Jessica. Again, this example of business leadership and how it can change things, I'd be love to hear about it from your perspective.
I need you to repeat the question because I can't follow.
Sorry, I should talk
too quickly.
I do apologize. And actually, given that we're trying to broadcast this, then there may be other people who are struggling with that as well. So this is a very good note that you give us. So I was just saying how in this conversation, there are two dynamics. So one is how some businesses can be more ambitious than other businesses, and that's really important. And the other one is how those leading businesses can prompt change beyond themselves, but in the wider economy. And I was asking, is that something, do you recognize those dynamics, and how do they seem from your perspective?
Well, in the case of a bank, I think that more than 90% of the the problem is in our clients, our customers, like here, Sokimich is the leading world company in mining and chemicals. And so he's the problem, not me. I mean that our financed emissions are the only way that we can deal with that is working with our customers, working with the communities in the territories, because we speak here, but things happen in the territories, in the cities, in the and there are the municipalities, the people that live, the people that work, the companies, the presence of the state, the social organizations of diverse types. So in our case, in the case of the bank, more than others' company, I think, the thing has to do with the customers.
So it sounds like collaboration is one of the key things for you.
Collaboration, working together is more than collaboration. We have to agree in how we move or they move. So it's completely true in our case.
And I also wonder, so Julie talked very clearly about how for her company, she's been seeing more and more how the climate crisis and the nature crisis need to come together. And I think you talk as well about the social dimensions. Do you see these different angles of people, nature, and climate change coming together more?
Absolutely, especially in our country. In our country, we are very vulnerable to climate change. This is beside the earthquakes and all of that is our daily nature. But we are very vulnerable. Beside that, we have a geography that's very special, challenging. And we, in our case, in Banco Estado's case, we are a bank that has a territory presence all over our country. So we're part of each of those communities, each of those, we have in Chile, we have 345 municipalities. Well, we work with 250 of them, and when you analyze how a municipality moves, I mean what they do, what they do, how they work with the people. There's down there is a network of financial movements that is there all day long, and we are there. So this thing of working in a community where it has to be all the ones that are in the territory is one of the things, one of the insights I get here.
Absolutely. And maybe if I come back to Julie, so I mean we've just
excuse me so much that I'm gonna look, because we have just finished our strategic statements, but this thing that the sustainable is as a value, it's good, huh? I like it. I think I'm gonna push it. That's why we're Salesforce customer.
Good. I hope you make sustainability a value. I love that. Take it. It should be all of our values.
Absolutely. And it's great to see international collaboration and learning happening on the fly there. So that's not pun unintended, actually.
We do. They're a customer of ours, okay. Which is great. Okay. We love collaborating with our customers.
Good stuff. I was going to ask you, so we heard from Jessica, I think, a perspective from the Chilean context. You are, you know, working in the UK and European context, but for a US company, how important do you find the local context to these conversations? We're talking about international collaboration, but I think there's a big piece about learning in terms of how what works in different places.
The local context is really important. I'm also an American working in London, so didn't grow up in the EU, didn't grow up in the UK, and I think one of the greatest values for Salesforce of all of our trade associations, and one that I definitely find in my work, is the real expertise that you all at CLG have, and the network and the connections that you are able to make and bring to the group is really phenomenal for many reasons. One, you're experts, which is great. But sustainability teams are generally pretty lean. And at Salesforce, you know, we have a solid team, but there's always more work to be done. And having a trade group like CLG Europe and UK really helps us to scale our work and do so in an impactful way, identify opportunities where we actually really will have impact. And without, you know, it just helps us do more, which is always a good thing. So I think that's a huge value add for us in the group. And there's real power also in coming together as a cohort of companies from multiple sectors wanting to progress certain issues. I think that that's something where we've seen power in numbers. We've seen that with, you know, the recent movement around mandatory climate disclosure, both in the US as well as in the EU and UK. We've seen that last year with ambitious NDCs and businesses being able to unite and push governments towards those ambitious commitments in advance of COP26. So many, many benefits of working together as a group, and some real inspiration as well. Almost got it that time.
Harry, back to you. So bringing this back to you, so I mean, I presume that this story of value and collaboration is one that you recognise. Maybe you could talk a little bit about that, but also about what you think some of the common goals that can arise from working together might be.
Yes, I'll gladly do that, but also a little bit on local context. I think making things fact-based and giving them local context is really relevant. Because then also people see what is the potential, what can be done. So for instance, when we worked in 2006, 2007 on all this lighting transition, in Europe, there were actually four factors at play. So energy saving, climate change, security of energy supply, and the economic angle through jobs. And in Europe, we played on all four, but we highlighted the climate angle. In the US, at the same time, we also played on all four, but we were less vocal on climate, but more on energy security and things like that. So that became then a chapter in the Energy Independence and Security Act. So in a way, you can see sometimes that on a high level and with politics and media, things may look different. But then if you look below, then yeah, you need to do the same things to achieve all those benefits. And I think in that way also, when you look at how do we collaborate, there are many things that we can look at in an integrated way. So how do certain technologies interact? If you save more energy, there's more electricity to charge cars or to electrify heating. If you work as different sectors together, you can really show like, hey, this is cross-sector. So all this remarks that we hear now fewer and fewer, that business is not in favor of this, are then, actually this resulted in those going away. Because then governments could see at national level, at European level, at global level, that this is really an innovation agenda. And the future depends on that. So innovation is, in that sense, it's very much needed, but it's also the race that we've been internally in and that has provided benefits and economic growth. And in this case, yeah, they're much smarter, resource efficient, climate friendly, more economical. So maybe those are a few points I think that are relevant for all of us working together.
Thank you, Harry. And can I put a similar question to you, Jessica? Can I ask you about some of the goals that you have together when you're working with your fellow companies in Chile, with CLG Chile, what are some of the things that bring you together that you're trying to achieve?
Well, we are in CLG. We work in... We are working also with the Global Compact. We signed a Race to Zero commitment. And I think that the value of getting together to talk about this, exchanging experience. For example, last night we were in a dinner, and I was in a table with two ladies that works in banks. So I think we're all learning in this process. So to have the possibility to share with a bank that has has worked first than us and know their experience, it's very valuable to share practices. So I think that is one of the good things that we work together. So I'm very committed to go back to Chile and to try to work with the other banks, because we used to compete too much. So who's the best? Who's in front of the race? And we're talking about a very important thing, but that has, we have to change something that makes that all the banks in Chile can sit and work together in this. And I think it's important, so I'm going to talk about this when I go back.
I think maybe I'll go with the last question to each of you, which is about, because I'm almost finishing where you started, I'd like to ask you about your experience of COP27. You started with saying it was very confusing, and I'd love to hear more about that. What some of the things that you've learnt and some of the things that you'll take home from the conversations that you've been able to have here?
Well, this is my first COP. I learned, or I realized a sense of urgency that I hope that I ruego, ¿cómo se dice ruego? Huh? I beg that this that doesn't disappear when I arrive to Chile and we get in the business and we forget. I think that the logistics is a challenge because it's too big for 40,000 people here. There's too many activities, impossible to have a sense of all. I don't know if too many organizations, it's very confusing. Who is who? It's related to who? Too many information and some cliché phrases that we hear everywhere. And so it's for me, it's confusing. But I think it's a very important experience. Yes.
Thank you, that's great to hear. And I agree with you, I hope that level, that understanding of urgency stays with us all when we go home. So I think it's a really important message. Julie, maybe if I could ask the same question of you, sort of some of the things that you're hoping from the rest of the conversation here at COP27, the things that you might take home, what are your perspectives on these couple of weeks?
Absolutely, there are a lot of people here. There's a lot to do, for sure, I definitely agree with that. And I think that is one of the joys of being here, is you have some really energizing conversations that just don't happen over Zoom, or just meeting with people in person is unparalleled. So it's really energizing, and that it's also against a backdrop that is incredibly serious and fraught with complication. And I think we're not seeing the... there's challenges that we still need to overcome. I think what I'm leaving with is a feeling that business is here, business is committed, we will remain committed, and committed means action. I'm seeing a lot of action, and I think we need to see more action, absolutely. I think on a personal level, I'm, as I said, excited by the increase in nature-related conversations I'm seeing here. We have CBD, the Biodiversity COP, coming up in December. I know a lot of people are focused on how do we keep the momentum from COP27 to COP15 in Montreal. So I'm excited to do that and feel like there have been some really valuable connections made here to help that happen.
Great. And Harry, same question to you.
Sorry. No, I'm taking two things with me. So one is even a stronger commitment to contribute to doubling the speed of action, because that's what we need. So let's also take away what we can do ourselves. And the second thing I take away is hope that we can also work more together, also north, south, developed, emerging, developing countries. And I hope that our leaders who have been here, and one is now actually speaking, you know, that they have sufficient leadership capabilities to look beyond a lot of issues that are on the table, like loss and damage and so forth, to really keep on, so not to not slow down this process, but to really look beyond that and to see like, hey, they're here, they've been elected. If they don't make it, then we know the risk is that things will get worse. That plays into populism. Then you get the wrong people, and then it gets even worse. So I really hope that our leaders have sufficient leadership capabilities to look beyond that and to make the north, south, or whatever you want to call it, that connection really stronger.
I'm going to note that, thank you, all three of you, for all your contributions. I'm going to note in that last round that we heard urgency, action, and urgent action. So I think that's really, really clear. And really, really important, but also hope and connectivity. And I think, you know, these are all really important themes that we'd like to take forward with the Corporate Leaders Network project. So it's that aim of being able to prompt collaboration, being able to prompt lesson learning and comparison of different experiences in different countries, so that we can support action at a greater speed, at a greater level of ambition than it might have had otherwise. And so I think that's going to be really valuable. Really appreciated everybody's engagement with this, both in the room, both panels have been excellent, and also online for everybody who's been able to follow us in that way. For those of you who are here, you have the bonus. So this is you have to experience the flies and the air conditioning and the noise levels. But you can join us for a reception now where you can join us for a drink. So please do that. For those of you who are online, you know, you've got the opposite side of that bargain. But thank you very much, everyone. And it's been a great conversation. And we look forward to continuing this conversation with you all. Thank you.
Very good, thank you.